So let's look at the objective. What we want to achieve by the end of the class today. Okay. You all here, so I'm assuming you're here for both the sessions? Mm-hmm, yeah. Yeah? All right. So first up, we'll understand the fundamentals of digital video. Second, you will identify the pre-production requirements. So if you want to produce anything, be it a film, be it like a news report, okay, be it like a very personal story on yourself, for example, what do you require to get started? How do you plan for it? Okay. Break down a scene into shots. Like everything that you need to do, you need to go down to the very detail. Right? How do you go down to the very detail? How do you think of something, you visualize something, and you break it down into very single shots? Okay? I've got like a demo footage. Okay? I'm gonna show it to you, explain it to you, and then you need to edit it yourself. Although you might be novice or you might be amateur or haven't started editing ever, the idea is that I will show you how to begin and how to assemble a scene together. Okay? And eventually you'll learn by yourself how to edit. Okay? And also we'll learn about post-production. What happens after you shoot and how it happens after you come back from shoot. Okay? So that entire process. So this is what we're gonna cover in today's session. So few ground rules. You can stop me at any point in time. There are no wrong answers. I'll ask questions and in between, and we'll do a quiz in between. And so there are no wrong answers. You can stop me at any point in time. All right. So feel free to participate. We have also an activity that we'll do in between the session. Okay. All right. So all set. Good to go. Great. So, do you have a story to say? Right now you are into summer break, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You're all going to be staying here. Or anyone going to India? Or, yeah, your plans? When are you flying?
July, August.
July, August. So when you come back from India, your friends here would be curious to know what you guys did?
No.
Yeah.
It won't be a usual story. Yeah, you go to India, meet your grandparents, come back, that's it.
So there's no excitement?
There's no excitement. Like, sir, we won't have that same excitement which we had like a few years back.
So it's all the same. It's a repeat. It's a repeat.
Just a repeated routine you have every day.
So when you come back, I mean, you know, just to not sound boring, right? And your friends ask you, like, what you did this summer? Like, you know,
Iceland.
Yeah, you know. So you would want to spin it around, right? Like, you know, spin it to make it sound interesting even you slept across the entire holidays, isn't it? So I mean, when you reach home and your mom asks you, what do you learn today? Like, what did you do today in school? Even though you did pretty much nothing maybe, but you will still say something, right?
Yeah, I got my mind.
So you all know how to tell a story. We all know. We are all good storytellers. Some are really good, some are bad, some are okay, and some manage, you know. So we all know how to tell a story. Okay? And we learn how to sequence things so the entire sequence of story sounds interesting, even though it might not be that interesting, as he clearly mentions, like, from his summer break experiences. So we retell, we rewind, we spice up, we tone down, we make adjustments, we remove things, we edit things. Okay, some are naturally good, some are bad, right? So I'll give you a story, and you need to spin it around for me. Mm-hmm. Okay? The story goes like this. Mary had decided to go for a walk. So she called up her dog, Spot, got him on a leash, and went outside. She walked down the sidewalk and crossed the street in front of a small neighborhood grocery store. She liked the store and was always happy to see the regular people who buy the food there. She kept walking until she got into the park. As always, the park was filled with dogs that were running and jumping and catching frisbees. Both she and Spot really liked it in the park. Regular story. So it's like a regular story, you know. So Mary is at home. She took her dog, goes out on a walk, crosses by a grocery store, eventually goes to a park. Both happy because they both like to be in the park where they jump, the dog can jump and run around, right? Okay. So I would like you to work in pairs. I mean, we are odd here. So both of you got together. Both of you get together. But if we get together, and three of you get together, all right? So I give you 10 minutes, take 5 minutes, okay? And tell me the same story, the exactly same story. So nothing changes, okay? Don't Don't make the story goes like that. The car comes and hits Mary. Okay. Don't do that. Don't kill Mary, or don't kill the dog.
So
you know.
No,
no. Just discuss among yourself, and just tell us the story. Tell us
so
your story.
Should we like tell like what shot to do this?
No. We'll get into that later. Right now, just modify the story. Make it exciting, or make it boring, or make it strange, or you know. But don't kill anyone. Yeah. No killing. No killing in the story. All right. So take 5 minutes, and we'll resume. All the cat lovers here, you can like, you know, close your ears, you know, from this point on.
Yeah.
We don't know what happens to Lucy. We don't want to know what happens to Lucy after that.
So they just save basically the dogs.
Basically dogs all
Lucy.
The dogs get together and
yeah.
You know, chase away Lucy the rude into the dog park.
Yeah, and Mary is happy with the dogs.
Okay.
And
okay. So we are looking at a lot of savior stories here. You know? Right, Mary could be a savior here. You know, the dogs are savior.
She goes back home. Mary goes back home to meet her mother and tell her what happened. Now she's really scared. She opens the door, and as soon as she opens the door, she hears a dog coming towards her barking. Basically, Spot came back from the park till there because he wasn't able to find Mary.
Intelligent dog. Imagine now if I give you one of your versions to all of you, one of your versions. So I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 versions of the same story. If I choose one of the versions and give it to all of you and say, make a film out of it, trust me, you'll all make 5 different films. Right? So the process of filmmaking, and when you want to produce a film from a story, there's a whole lot of process that goes into it. A lot of collaborators comes and joins the team and bring their involvement and their insight into the film. And it becomes a very different film. But what you guys just did, okay? Is that I told you a story, all right? And you tried to create a plot, okay? Now, to give you a basic definition, everybody knows the story of Titanic.
Yep.
What James Cameron came up with is a plot. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So all those things are very, very important, putting those finer details. And how you're going to show it in the film? Is it going to be through dialogues? Does everything needs to be expressed through dialogues? Not necessary, right? It's expression, it's the location, the setting, the house, how the house looks from inside, what kind of lighting you have inside the house. Is the house looks gloomy, sad, exciting, fun? What kind of sofas, colors you choose? What is the color of your carpet? There's a movie called Psycho of Hitchcock, mm-hmm. And there's a storyboard for that, okay? Shot by shot.
Shot by shot.
Shot by shot. Yeah? And then, have you heard of Martin Scorsese?
Yes.
Okay. He hates doing storyboard. So, in fact, he does storyboard himself. He doesn't take any. So, all this is obviously done by a storyboard artist. So, you'll find a lot of. Like, in fact, now, for you guys, you can actually explore a lot of free storyboard options. There are like a lot of animation softwares which can let you create storyboard. In fact, you can create an entire room and create characters and beard and face, facial like features and all that. And all that is available pretty much. So it might be more detailed in certain places, okay? But bottom line, this is what you need to know. You need to know the location. Why? Because, you know, do I move the camera out? Do I move the camera in? You know, then you need to understand the shot type. We'll talk about shot types. Okay, so shot type means the size of the character and where the camera is. Now, right now, you can see the camera is right there. If Mr. Sangram, who is behind the camera, if he's completely zoomed out, then we are, then he would be looking at his frame is a long shot. So if somebody is angry or somebody is really happy, you can't take a wide shot. You need to show the expression of the person, isn't it? So that's why you require different shot types. Camera angle. Where is the camera? Right now the camera is in the eye level. You can see where the camera is? It's at the eye level. Why do you think it's in eye level? Because the audience who's going to be watching this video, for example, we are equal. Suppose you want me to show as a very, you know, strong and very rude or very scary teacher. Should we keep the camera here, like low angle? Camera movement. Yeah? The camera can't be still, no? Nowadays, camera is moving all the time. Going to all kinds of places, right? Places there you thought you'd never go. Yeah, exactly, right? And with obviously the better technology and cheaper, you know, options available, you have seen all nowadays you're all familiar with Steadicam,
yep.
Right? With a simple gimbal, you can just, you know, go. So imagine that's a heavy camera. That camera will weigh around, more than 6-7 kgs.
That's it.
Yeah? And certain older broadcast cameras will be more. I mean, if there's a used to be a camera called Ikigami. Ikigami would weigh around 15 to 16 kgs. And, the Ikigami will put it on your shoulder and you just have to forget. Because it will not shake. It will be so heavy. How can you shake it? Right? You need to be, you know, so it is great for documentary filmmaking. Because you can just carry around the camera entire day. You don't need a tripod. You can go anywhere you want with the camera. And in between, you also go online and do things and go to Facebook. And you're also doing that also for you. Right? 1 second. So that is what your laptop hard drive is doing. Right? Now, if you put your footage also in the same hard drive, then you're asking too much from the poor guy. Right? So if you give the footage and everything to do with the footage to a different hard drive, you are giving a lot of breathing space to your laptop hard drive. And because now you have USB 3 and, you know, much better transportation between a portable hard drive and your laptop, so they can talk to each other in a much faster way. Always, I imagine when you use a portable hard drive and you're working on HD, for example, it's like Premiere Pro is playing table, like in a lawn tennis with the footage. So the footage is throwing a ball at Premiere. Premiere is trying to catch it. If the hard drive is throwing too many balls at less time, then the Premiere Pro will miss those balls, right? And those are called missing frames. Yeah, we'll talk about frames when we go a little detail. But please understand, for safety's sake and for good health of your hard drive, of your laptop, always work with a portable hard drive. Okay? So, I don't... Just copy that switch says tense, CNC tense, the whole folder. So here, for this exercise, okay, I have got... I mean, this is too heavy file, so it won't be able to handle it. Yeah, so you have to ideally work in a laptop. So you can just watch. So let me just tell you how we're going to do it, okay, guys, everyone. You're right now copying the footage. You will edit with the footage eventually, okay? So don't worry that you don't have it now. You just go through what I'm telling you, okay? Once I explain to you how to edit it, you can edit it yourself, okay? Right now, just see the process. So I'm saving this file. Now, this is a project file, okay? Now, this is my recommendation that you can always choose not to follow, but this is my recommendation. I always keep my project files in my hard drive, in a cloud. So I have Dropbox. I always save all my project files in my Dropbox. Why? Imagine a scenario. Imagine two scenarios. You save your project file in your portable hard drive. While editing, your portable hard drive crashes. Okay? So all the footage is gone and the project file is gone. Can't be recovered. You save your project file on your laptop hard drive. And your footage in your portable hard drive. Your laptop crashes. Okay? Your project file is gone. You can't use it anyway. There's no point. Right? Now imagine the third scenario. Your footage is in the portable hard drive. Your project file is in Dropbox, in a cloud. Both crashes. Laptop crashes, portable hard drive crashes. Now I have my project file. All I have to do is go back to my camera, copy the footage. I can connect everything, I can resume my work. So to be on a safer side, this is what I do. I always save all my project files in my Dropbox while I'm working. So because Dropbox will keep syncing, no?
Yeah.
So what happens, at least I'll have the last updated project file with me. Got it?
But if you're working on big files and Dropbox is like...
No, see, always remember project file is a very, very small file size.
Oh, okay. So you're saving only...
It is with few KBs, that's all.
Yeah.
Okay, it is a file which is managing all the footages. Always look at a project file as an edit decision list. It just has all the information of how you're editing. All the media is still lying in the portable hard drive. All the footage is still lying in the portable hard drive. Okay. All right, so I'm just giving it a name. I'm going to my Dropbox. Okay, this is my Dropbox. Okay, and I'm just creating a folder here called Summer Camp. And I'm just choosing this folder. I'm already calling it Nikon School Edit Demo, and ignore all of this, and click on OK. All right, this is what you get. This is common to all softwares. Okay, they might call it by different name, but it's common to all softwares. This is your project window, or what you call it, a project explorer. Okay, all the media, all the files you're bringing into the project will be here. This is your source. So whatever you're bringing, you'll first check, no, what you want, what you don't want. It will play here. So when you double click anything here, it will play here. So you will give an in point and an out point. Can someone tell me why do we give an in point and an out point?
For a good start of the film?
Every shot that you'll shoot, right? You need to choose a point where you want to use it from, right? When you say action and the actor walks, right? You will choose a point where you want the actor to walk, right? Mm-hmm. And you'll choose a point where you want the actor to stop. Mm. In point, out point. You will do that here. That's your source. And why you're here? Because you want to edit, right? You want to put things together. So this is the first shot. You'll drag it and you'll bring it here. This is called a timeline. This is where the edit happens. And this is a sequence. So when you play it, it plays here. Okay, so source, program. First window is because whatever footage you're bringing, from there you will do a fine selection first, no?
Okay.
So you'll give an in-point, out-point, you'll bring it here. Shot number two, in-point, out-point, bring it here. So this plays your sequence, it plays here. This is your source.
Okay.
Got it? Did you understand? Yeah? So that's pretty much the entire workflow for all softwares. They might call it by a different name, they might have a different shortcut, but it's all the same. Clear? Now, my project is ready, empty. I need to bring in the files, okay? Now, as always in life, in general, if you keep it organized, it's better, right? So always keep it organized. So if this is my folder, I will create a new bin. For that, I will just right-click, and new bin is like a folder. I'll create a new bin, and I'll call it footage. Okay, there are two kinds of view, just like Windows. There's a thumbnail view, and there's a list view, okay? If you look down here, can you see? Wait, just follow my mouse. This is a list view. This is a thumbnail view. Okay? So let me be in the list view itself so you can see the entire folder. Right click, new bin. I'll call it music. I might bring in some music. Yeah? And I will make a folder called sequence. So I'll have different sequences. The best part about this editing software and all others, you can make a copy of a sequence. Suppose you did edit. Alright? You put it together. You want to just use the same footage to make it funny, for example. Like suppose right now we want to do a tense edit, right? But with the same footage, you want to make a comic edit also, for example. So you can make multiple sequences within the same project. You can make a copy of your existing sequence also. You can make a duplicate of your existing sequence also. All this you can do within one project. Okay? So right now I have these three things put together. I have a sequence, footage, and music. I want to bring in the footage now. Now you might have copied from the USB to your hard drive. I will just go to footage folder, right click, and I'll click on import. So it will open the dialog box. So mine, I just downloaded them. So it's lying on my download folder. So where is it? Yeah, this one. Okay, so here, if you can see exercise files, I mean, it will look like this. This is the four folder you got. So I'm going to select all. and import. Sequence. Right now my timeline is empty. Okay. Now here comes a little bit of understanding about digital video. Well, how do you understand HD? What is HD?
High definition.
I know. Thank you. A little bit more than that. What is
higher
HD?
Definition.
Huh?
Higher.
I know. Higher definition is higher and higher and higher than
more pixels.
More pixels. Is that it?
More clarity.
That's it.
More expressive.
So then what difference between HD and 4K? Like 4K is more higher pixels?
More light.
More light? Okay. More light, is it like more light you see on the
screen?
Less screen.
The emphasis is on light.
Okay.
More depth.
To just like, you know, make it simpler, HD means a certain frame size. Means the frame, the how big or small it is, in the number of pixels. Okay? That's what HD is. And there are other things also, but primarily for your concern, it's the frame size. The best part is if I go to my list view here, and I do a tilt key again, and I scroll, and you can see there's a whole lot of details I can see. Can you see? Yeah? Now, look closer here. What do you see here? I can see media start, media end, blah, blah, blah. I can also see video info. What do you see here? 1280 by 720 resolution. That's your frame size. Now, this is regarded to be as 720.
720p.
No, no. P is not pixel. P stands for progressive. Okay? I'll require a different class for explaining that, but I'll just make sure it's not pixel. So when first HD ever came, 720, as you can see here, it is always progressive. Okay? Another number you'll see often also, you see 1280, no? It will be 1920. And 720 in the place will be 1080. That is another level of HD. There are two levels of HD. The 1080 I'm talking about is full HD. They both are considered HD. Okay? In this case, it is 720p. The next case, it's higher. Higher frame size means bigger. You understand when I say bigger, no? It's bigger. Okay? Then comes 2K, which is, okay, you can see the number, no? It's increasing. 1280, 1920. It becomes getting bigger and bigger, no? Then it becomes into 2000s. Then it goes into 4000s. 4000s becomes 4K. 6000s becomes 6K. 8000s becomes 8K. That's your frame size. When you say HD, you're talking about primarily the frame size. Okay? What's next? Okay? There are more things that you can find out. If you right click and you look at properties, okay? Let's see what it shows. What do I see? I also see something called frame rate. Can someone explain me frame rate? Right.
Technically, a video is a collection of images.
Exactly. Exactly. A video is a collection of images. That's how you see motion. Right? And what is the rate at which the images are moving per second is your frame rate. What frame rate do you see here? Considered to be 30. 30, it's called in short 30 FPS, frames per second. Okay, so if you're shooting in film, what frame rate are you shooting in?
120.
If you're shooting in film, you're shooting in 24.
Yeah.
Right? If you're shooting, now when I say film, I actually mean film. I mean real, real film, like cellulose. Like what Christopher Nolan shoots in. If you're ever using a film camera, you're shooting in 24. That does not mean the latest digital camera do not allow you to shoot in 24. They also do so. So don't you think the sequence should match the clip settings?
Yes.
Ideally speaking, yeah? So I'm just enforcing it here. How do I enforce it? As simple as this. I will just take any clip, okay? Because all the clips are the same settings. And I'll drag it here, down. That's the fastest way to create a new sequence. Just watch what happens. Just watch on the screen. You can see suddenly the timeline came alive. Mm-hmm. I've got the same clip which I dragged in the timeline. I'm calling it a timeline. And if you look here, you can see a new icon has popped up. Can you see the icon?
Yeah.
Now, every icon is a very thoughtful icon. It's not like randomly they've done all this. Video, audio. Right? Doesn't this look like a timeline?
Yeah.
Yeah? So this is like a timeline, or what you call as a sequence. So this is my sequence. Right? Now, if I go back to my another window here, if I go to footage, I have all this footage, and I can see a sequence here. I should rename it. I'll call it assembly tense. Right? And I should put it in the right place. Where it should be? In my sequence folder. I'll just drag and drop it. So sequence folder has one sequence now, my sequence. Now obviously, when I come back here, this is my sequence. I don't want to start like this, obviously. I want to start from the very beginning. I'll delete it. My sequence still remains, but it's empty. And I got exactly the same setting as the clip. Are we clear until here? Cool?
Sure.
So let me just repeat. I just dragged any clip to timeline, made a new sequence, renamed it, put it in its right folder. That's all I did. Cool? So my sequence is empty. I'm ready to edit now. All good? All right? So I'll come back to my bin folder, and I'll come back to my bigger view, and come back to my thumbnail view. What's the first shot? He's walking in?
Yes.
Yeah? This is the first shot? I've got two takes, as you can see, this one and this one. Okay? So what do I do? Now you want to see how it looks like, right? So you can always double click it. It'll open here. Where? What is this called? Source. Okay? Now since I'm using my Bluetooth speaker, so I'll just change my audio hardware to my speaker. Where are you? Yeah. Okay, so let's play it. I can also make it bigger. Yeah?
Sorry. So it's like another slide.
Another
slide? I missed it. Check on the camera. No way. That's too close. Just call it out again.
Roll one, take one.
So now what I'm doing, okay, this is a very important thing I'm doing here. I'm basically jogging my view, okay? So for editing, you use these three fingers, okay? And with these three fingers, you can pretty much do everything. You don't need a mouse also, okay? Now these three fingers, if you look at a keyboard, there is J, K, L. Can you see? Three fingers, J, K, L. Okay, L is for playback. You press L once, all right? I press L once, it plays. Can you see it plays? I press K, it pause.
J is rewind.
And if I want to push J, it will go and rewind.
Yeah.
If I... Sorry?
Even in YouTube, it's like that.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's pretty much a common thing to do, but the best part is, if I press L more than one times, it'll fast playback also. So with just J, K, L, I can pretty much look for my right spot. Okay? So what's my right spot? Let's find out. So I want this to start. The moment he appears, it goes out of focus, in focus, maybe here. Maybe here. Now this is the point I want to start the video, my edit. Now J, K, L, right on top you'll see I and O. Can you see I and O?
Yeah.
Same finger, just press I. What happened when you press I? It added a in point. Okay? It added the in point. Now I have to look for the out point. Okay? So I'll press L. He comes, opens the door, walks in, and he here, maybe. Just assuming. I want to put the next cut here. What do you want to cut to? A close-up shot. Okay? And I'll press O. You can always change this, by the way, but don't worry. You can always... Okay, now, first job done. Source done. Now, it has to be bought here. Okay? So, there are multiple ways. There are many ways, 1,000 ways of doing that. Okay? By default, this is your playhead. Okay? It is in the very beginning now. I can click and drag, and what do I get? Audio and video both?
Yes.
I can put it anywhere. I can select it. I can bring it to the very beginning. This is one method. Okay. Another method is I can click and I can drag, and you can see all these options here. Can you see? It says insert before, replace, override, insert after. Too many things, too many options. Like, what are they? Right? You're suddenly getting too many options here. Insert before is the playhead. Is there anything before the playhead? It's in the very beginning anyway, right? Insert after the playhead. Okay, if you have a clip already, you want to replace it. Okay, you want to override things. If it's a clip already, it will just override it. Okay, so it doesn't matter because it's empty anyway. My timeline is empty, there's nothing, no? So I can use anything, I'll get it. Right? If you do not want to use mouse and just play with your keyboard, if my source window is selected right now, can you see blue here? I have already given my input point. You can just press a comma in your keyboard. You have comma in your keyboard, right next to M? Yeah? Press comma, same thing. Cool. First shot done. Mm-hmm. Right? Now I have to go for next shot, which is a close-up shot. So what I'll come back here, make it active, make it bigger, and look for the shot. Okay? And this is the shot. This is the shot, right? So I'll double-click it. It'll come here. I'll press again L. Walks in. So you need to match it, right? That's the beauty, you know. If I come back to my timeline here, this is my shot. You can see how, where he is, where his hand is. Can you see where his hand is? Right? And look here. Right? So he's bringing his hand here. Is it a match, more or less? He's putting his hand inside a pocket, no? This is coming from here. The last frame. Yeah, I need to match this with what is coming next. Right? Now, it will not be an exact match now. I can always do a fine tune later. Okay? But I'll still try to do a nice job even now itself. Okay? So, I can give an endpoint here. Yeah? And play. And he stops. And I'll stop when he looks at her. Yeah? He's looking at her. Yeah? Out. Where's my keyboard? In the last frame? Yeah? So I'll just do a comma. Got my next shot. Now he's looking at her. So the audience should look at her also. Mm-hmm. Like, we need to know who is she looking at, right? So we'll come back to this, go to tilde key, and find a shot of her. Okay? Now there are different shots of here. Okay. So yeah, I think this is the one. So here in the very beginning, she's reading, right? I'm just waiting for it to get stable. Yeah? So in point, out point. Good enough. Few seconds. So again, I'll press comma. So he's looking at her. Now again, we have to go back to him, right? Because he decides to come in, see her. Come and say hi to her. So we'll again go back to the same shot, right? I'll come back here. And this is a shot, right? Where he's looking at her. Yeah, but I think we also have a close-up shot. Yeah, this is what we last used. Okay, fine. So we can jump to the out point by using this last out point. And then he's like, you know, thinking, should I say hi to him? Hi, like he's thinking like that. No, so I'll just give an in point. He's like curious. Should I go? Should I not go? I think I'll come back and say hi to her. This is so embarrassing. And out point. Okay. So now I'm gonna put my comma here. Now let's see how we've edited so far. Yeah? So I'll press the program monitor and play. This is how we've edited so far. So like that, so that's how you pretty much build the scene. You can't wait, right, to start? Yeah? So please remember the basic principles. We will always fine-tune later. Okay? We'll fine-tune later. But just build the sequence exactly how I showed you so far. Okay?